Hello everyone, this is the review tutorial for ENGG 2430A, Probability and Statistics for Engineers. In the tutorial, we will give a brief review of what we have learned so far. In this video, we are mainly focused on the materials in the first 2 weeks. Descriptive statistics of data, concentration inequalities such as Chebyshev inequality and Markov inequality. I will show you how to deal with the concepts through some simple examples. Okay, this is the first example. It reads so long, and there are multiple sub-questions. When we encounter such a long problem, which may have too much redundant information, we first need to extract useful information. Since this problem is about sample statistics, the most efficient way to extract information is to extract the useful numbers. After a glance at the problem, we find that what we are focusing on are the position errors of the GPS receiver. So, we don't need the operating parameters of the satellites, such as the number of satellites is redundant, how far away are the satellites, the speed and the period of the satellites are all redundant. Only the sample size 19 and the sample values are useful. After discarding the redundant information, the problem becomes much clearer. The sample size is 19, and we have the 19 sampling values. Before going on, we first sort the unordered data. Now, we have made 4 preparations. Let's begin to solve the first sub-question. We first calculate the total summation of the sample space. It's very easy with help of a calculator. We get 1882.8. Then divide by the sample size 19, we get the sample mean, 99.09. Next, since the sample size is 19, median is 19 plus 1 over 2, which is the 10th value of the sorted data, 97.5. Mode is 97.5 since it appears twice, while all other data appear only once. At last, we come to determine the standard deviation of the sample. Recall that standard deviation is a statistic that measures how data are sparse away from the center. A smaller standard deviation means the data are centered close to the mean. And a larger standard deviation means you have data that are spread away from the mean. Standard deviation has 2 different formulas, depending on whether we have the entire set of entries or just the sample. The only difference between the 2 formulas that you have is what in the denominator of the fraction. In the denominator of the fraction of the formula for the population standard deviation, you divide by the total number of the data values in your population. And for the case of sample, you divide by the number of your sample minus 1. Most of the time, when we are asked to find the standard deviation, it's referred to the standard deviation of sample. However, if sometimes your sample size is also very large, the formula is not friendly for calculation, especially when you have a very ugly mean. So, we now give an equivalent expression which is much more friendly to calculate. This equivalent formula can be easily obtained by expanding the binomial in the original expression. Now, You even don't need to know the mean. And of course, get rid of calculating the difference between the mean and each value. With this formula, the rest calculation will be left to the calculator. We get the standard deviation of the sample, S equals 9.25. Next, we come to the second subquestion, where we are asked to draw a histogram. Recall that to visualize data by graphs, we have learned histogram, pie chart, and bar chart. So before drawing the histogram, let's first review these concepts and see why we want to draw histogram here rather than pie chart or bar chart. Pie charts are generally used to show percentage or proportional data. It's great at comparing a given category with the total in a single chart. But when there are too many categories, it is difficult for the eye to distinguish. When we are comparing different categories, bar chart is more efficient. However, if we want to see the distribution of quantitative data, histogram should be used. Hence, different from bar charts, bars in histograms cannot be reordered. So be careful that although histograms are made up of bars, they are not bar charts. In this problem, we are considering quantitative data and want to know their distribution. So a histogram is our best choice. Now, let's draw the histogram. There are three values lie between 79.95 and 89.95. So the height of the first bar is 3. Then, it's a repeated work to draw the rest. There are respectively 9, 4, 2, and 1 values lie in the rest bars. Till now, we finished the histogram, and it's time for the last subquestion. Here, we want to know the probability that a random observation lies within a given interval. Recall that when introducing statistics in the first few weeks, we have learned Chebyshev's inequality, which bounds the proportion of data that lie within an interval around the mean. After we have learned the concept of random variables last week, now we can reformulate Chebyshev's inequality through random variables. Suppose we have a random variable x with finite expected value mu x and a standard deviation sigma x. For any positive real number k, the probability that the random variable falls within k times standard deviation around the expected value should be greater than or equal to 1 minus 1 over k squared. However, we notice that in the statement of Chebyshev's inequality, the interval we are interested in is something determined by the population parameters, the expected value, and the standard deviation. But we now only have a sample at hand. Fortunately, it's assumed that the sample accurately reflects the population. So, we can use the obtained sample statistics as the population parameters. Then, the expected value equals 99.09. The standard deviation equals 9.25. Thus, in the example, the probability that a random observation lies between 80.59 and 117.59 equals the probability that the value lies within 2 times standard deviation around the expected value, which by Chebyshev's inequality is greater than or equal to 1 minus 1 over 2 squared, which is 75%. In conclusion, the probability that a random observation lies between the given interval is at least 75%. Next, let's consider another example focusing on standardization. Suppose we know the mean and standard deviation of the GPAs of all students in a college, which is a population. Moreover, we are given the standardized scores of two students, A and B. So, now we want to know the actual scores of the two students. Recall that standardized value indicates how many standard deviations an individual observation is from the mean of the data set. In the case of population, the standardized value Zi corresponding to some Xi equals to Xi minus mu over sigma. However, we notice that the standardized values are given in the example, what remains unknown are the original scores. Don't worry, we can use the inverse formula, Xi equals mu plus Zi times sigma. Then, the actual scores of the two students are respectively 2.39 and 3.34. And we notice that when the standardized value is positive, the actual value will be greater than the mean, and vice versa. In fact, this is a universal conclusion which can be easily seen from the formula. Okay, this is the end of the tutorial. Thank you for watching.